You can see the topic. We're going to talk about data. And I'm sure you've heard a lot about data. This is becoming, I think, the latest buzzword. No, it is a four-letter word, but luckily a good four-letter word. And I heard a very interesting story. It is becoming such a fad. Data is becoming such a fad. You know, I just could not resist but share the story that I just heard 10 minutes back. And Deepak, sorry for stealing this one. Deepak was mentioning that, you know, a friend of his was telling him that in New York, his laundry person came to him and he said, I know every label that exists, every dressmaker's label that exists in this world. I see a lot of them come in and go every day. I have all this data sitting in my head. How can I monetize that? So this is where the world is headed, right? Everybody's sitting on some information, some data, and everybody's looking at how can you use this data. So as we think about it from a banking perspective, I thought we would just start and first look at data, right? And truly there is a data explosion. You cannot imagine the amount of data that exists. I'm sure you've seen a version of this. This just talks about, as I speak, what's happening in the 60 seconds. The numbers are staggering. Right? You're looking at 3.5 million Google searches, literally 1 million logins to Facebook, and you can go on. You can read the numbers. I will not go into that. But it is staggering, the amount of data that exists and is getting consumed. You could look at me and say, but how does this impact banking, right? This has got nothing to do with banking. I guess both the good news and the bad news is this does not stop. It's true for banking as well. There is data everywhere. Here is something, this is for India. We try to look at individuals and said what kind of information is already existing. So whether it's about identity, whether it's about financial status, legalities, assets, land, you can go on, travel. There's already a lot of data, and that's getting captured by a large number of people. So different entities are capturing a large amount of data. Right? And you are leaving a digital footprint with any activity that you do, whether you buy tickets to travel, whether you go online to buy something, whether you buy land, whether you use your mobile phone to make payments, there is a large amount of data getting captured on you with different people. And it's exactly the same for corporates. This is not only for individuals, but also for corporates. There is a large amount of data. And to tell you how much data you have on you, let me give you an example. A couple of years back, I had a marketing or a social media marketing company. I had the head of one of these startups come to me and say, Alpesh, let me tell you the power of data. Can you just give me your email address? So to cut a long story short, I gave him my email address, the one that I use regularly. He came back to me in 24 hours with 3 pages. Page 1 was literally my history. He said, you're 45 years old, you have a 13-year-old daughter, you have a 9-year-old son, you do this, you worked here, you worked there. It was my life in one slide. So he looks at me and says, is this correct? I read it and I said, yes, 99% correct. So he said, are you impressed? You know, obviously humans being humans, when a fortune teller tells us the past, we don't get excited. So I said, I'm sure this is easy to get, that's fine. Let's move on. So he pressed enter, got onto the second slide. He says, now let me get into the world of, you know, in a way thinking and hypothesizing about you. What really makes you tick? What are your passions about? So he starts, he tells me, you are a mad follower of sport. You like running. You have run 30 half marathons. Here is your time. And interestingly, you've gotten better with age. You like cricket. You like soccer. This is what you do. So that was hobby one. He says, you are a voracious reader. And he told me what books I had read. And he says, you actually like travel a lot. here are your last five vacations. So I looked at him and I said, how the hell do you know? He says, well, Facebook for the travel. I said, well, I am not on Facebook and I never have been. He says, doesn't matter. Your friends are on Facebook. Once I get your picture, all I have to do is go around and look for your picture, right? You don't have to be on Facebook. So unless you have done a vacation without friends, I will know where you are. So, okay, that was the scary part. Big Brother is watching. If that wasn't enough, he said, okay, are you ready for the last one? So he hit enter. And the last line had a title which said, you are worth X. Right? Your net worth is X. So I looked at it. I didn't react. He says, Alpesh, you have to react. Tell me, am I correct? Am I close or not? I said, well, that depends on your definition of close. He says, am I within 20-30%? Because if I am a business and I want to take a decision on you, all I need to know is, are you worth 1 lakh? Are you worth 10 lakh? Are you worth 100 lakh? Are you worth more? And accordingly, I can try and sell you stuff. So I said, well, if that's the objective, yes, you are within 20% of where it is. So I asked him, I said, how do you get this? And that's the scary part. It's so easy. He says, you're on LinkedIn. I know where you spent the last 25 years of your life. I go to Glassdoor. I can get your income. Once I know your income, I know the tax rates in India. All I had to guess was, what's your savings rate and what's your investment income? And I played around with those scenarios and I can put a range around how much you're worth. And I can do this for everybody whose email address I have. He said, well, not quite everybody, where I can get a hit, which was about 25-30% at that point of time. And he says, I've not broken a single law in this land. This is all out there in the web. So bottom line, there is a ton of data out there. So second question is then, can we use it? Along comes this law, which helps you enhance computing power. I'm sure all of you have heard this. Gordon Moore went on record in the 60s to say, the computing capability of the semiconductor chips, basically, if I translate that into English, will double every 18 to 24 months, and the cost will halve. It was as simple as that. When you look at this, it's still not as, how shall I put it, as exciting. But if you look at the power of multiplying, it is actually scary. Again, you might have heard the story. The person who invented chess and one of these kings got very magnanimous, old-fashioned Indian style, said, tell me what you want. And he expected the person to say, give me my weight in gold, give me diamonds. He said, can you give me one grain of rice on the first block, two on the second, keep doubling that. And the king was really flabbergasted, saying, of all things you ask for rice? Little did he know that he would go bankrupt. The 10 square, and as you do the power of 2, 2 raised to 10 is 1,000. So the 10 square needs 1,000 grains. The 20th needs 1,000,000. The 30th, 1,000,000,000. The 40th, 1,000,000,000,000. And after that, I don't know how to count. By the time you get to those squares, you're actually looking at this number on the 64th square. Okay? So that's the power of multiplying. And if you think this is science fiction, let me make it real. My first computer in 1989, I paid 42,000 for this, had 4 MB RAM. I know people will laugh at this. And a 40 MB hard disk. This was an HCL 286. And I was on top of the world. Today, the computer I use has already gone up between 2 and 10,000 times. It is significantly cheaper. I'm not even doing the adjustment on inflation. And so the question I have is, what's going to happen next? This is just, it has, if you actually take Moore's law for 27 years, 12,000 exactly hits the doubling every 2 years. It's scary. So everybody says this can't continue. I'm willing to bet it will continue. So you put the two together, there is a lot of data. Computing power is just multiplying, you know, it's. So what's possible? What's possible from a banking perspective is you can actually impact the entire value chain, everything. From the credit decision, to monitoring, to cross-sell, to real-time marketing, you name it. Even to talent, right? You can control everything and you can change the way every process happens. Just take a couple of examples. So look at the data banks are sitting on. You, in the banking industry, sit on a lot of data. You know when I get my bonus. If you have my salary account, you know exactly when my bonus comes into my account. You could actually just tap me and say, why don't you invest this money into X, Y, all the investment options. You know when I buy a ticket. I buy a ticket online, I pay for it, you can hit me and say, why don't you buy travel insurance? Do you need it? The amount of information sitting out there, and this is already happening in bits and pieces, the question is, how can you do it on a more sustained basis? And a good example of that, I will not try and take an Indian example with the fear of, you know, offending a few others. So this is a bank in Poland, mBank. They have only about 5 to 6 million customers. They process this data, and they actually hit a customer to say, they go to, for example, out of the 5 million customers, 1 million people would buy a pair of Nike or buy a pair of sneakers every year. So they went to Nike and they said, guess what? I have 1 million customers who buy a pair of sneakers. You only have 25% market share in that. If you want to change that, give my customers a 30% discount. Right? And they use that to create offers for their customers which are completely customized. So my web page is going to be different from your web page. It's going to be different from a third person's web page because the most relevant 5 offers, if you don't buy sneakers, you will not get an offer from Nike. Right? And you can just imagine the power of this. They're doing this incredibly well. It is amongst the most successful users of data that I've seen. Right? So if I put this together, lots of data, great computing power, you can transform banking. The question you could ask is, are we seeing all of that? And if not, what's holding it back? Right? And I would just like to highlight 4 or 5 things that I think are holding it back in the Indian context. Data is quite useless if you cannot make sense out of it. So data is only useful as the base if you can convert that into information. You have information, then you have to process that and interpret that to convert that into knowledge. So tongue in cheek, what do you think this picture is about? It's interesting, right? This woman's talking to I don't know who. And it's quite fascinating. Is it a man with a duck ring or a duck with a man ring? Right? That's the beauty of data. You can actually interpret it in multiple different ways. Right? And hence, that's what is most critical. The third one is obviously technology. How do we make sense out of all of this? You know, all our systems need to talk. And tongue in cheek, I put up this picture. I don't know how many of you, I grew up looking at these MTNL and BSNL circuit boards. The only people who could make sense out of this was the linesman. If you walk into your building, wherever there's a fixed line, even today, it's even more complicated than this. I've taken the simple picture. It is scary. I have no idea how they even know which cable is to go where. That's what our IT networks remind me of today. Right? We will have to simplify this. Number 4, nobody likes to talk about it. Like I said, I was flabbergasted with the data that was out there. As consumers, we don't know what we're putting out. Our footprint is massive. But does that give companies the right to use this? What about privacy? How do you think about that? What about the ethics and the morality? You know, again, can you use this? So I was a part of a very, very philosophical debate, which I will not even try and have here. But for example, not banking, but if I take insurance, the whole idea of insurance is the pooling of risk. Right? So there are 300 people here. We all buy insurance. 10 of us might need it at some point of time. But the other 290 also pay for it. With data, if you can predict who needs it? Is it moral? I need the insurance. So is it fair for an insurer to deny me the insurance because my claim is going to be high? And if not, then you can't use the data. So it's good to say there's a lot of data, you can use it, but along come all these questions which are about ethics and morality, which says, can you use it? Because you're going to do a disservice to society. And obviously security, that's the last one I would like to put up, which is obviously a real threat. If you combine all of this together, there are many of these challenges. As you start looking at moving from data to information to knowledge to understanding to wisdom. But the most important one is the mindset. Because I say this in all humility, but for the first time in history, we have hit a situation where the younger people with more experience, with less experience, are going to know more about something than the older people with more experience, which is digital and data. All the decision-making right is with the older guys, but the ideas are with the younger guys. How do you blend the two? Organizations that blend these two together very well will actually benefit all the way and laugh all the way to money, and the others will struggle. Right? So I would just like to end with a very simple saying. I don't know who Tim O'Reilly is, but I love the saying, which basically says if the last decade or two was all about technology and software, the next decade is going to be all about data. I think the software is an incremental return, we have it. It's going to be about how you use the software to use this data. Okay. So with that, I would just put up three questions for the panel to talk about. Do we think leveraging, using this data is an agenda item for 2015, which is the past? Should we already have started? Is this a here and now topic? Is it 2020 or is it a topic for the future? Is this science fiction? Where do we see Indian banks in this journey today? And lastly, how do we think the banks can deal with these challenges? Right? With that, I will stop. Thank you. And I will actually ask, why don't I get the panel here to talk about their thoughts on this. Deepak, if I may ask you to start.
Thanks, Alpesh. I think the agenda for data was data agenda of yesterday, but we all recognize that it's better late than never. And a lot of us have already boarded the bandwagon. But just as I said, 2015 also, let me put a few things in perspective. 90% of the data, what we talk of today, was created in last 2 years. So to that extent, if we are in 2017, referring to 2015, we are okay, we are not too late. However, I think the bigger challenge is not just with data, but it's about what do we do with data. And while a lot of data is there, but the computational power of the data is still getting built on. So when we talk of AI and machine learning, I think our ability to use the large quantum of data to create the meaningful insights and actionable analytics is something where I would say by 2020 or somewhere before 2020, we'll be able to see a large value for Indian organizations and especially banks.
Thanks, Deepak. If I may, Mr. Rath, if I can ask you to talk about your perspective on the same.
Yeah, good afternoon, friends. So this definitely, data is enriching our thought process, I would say. Because till yesterday, we didn't have many data, but today we have data. So to me, when our goal is to kind of, increase the farmers, doubling the farmers' income by 2022, we cannot wait for 2020 to kind of use analytics. So definitely, 2015 is, agenda. And it's not that, banks have not started using. We have been starting all of the use of information and data analytics has started, quietly 2 years back. And what if we look back and see how we are using data what is a banker's friend? I think the panel discussion captures data is banker's friend. A banker would be happy if he does his selling, he meets his target so that he doesn't run away from his boss. And he does a kind of good decision by underwriting the loan process, so he sleeps sound sleep in the night. And of course, if he can does a cost, saving, so that will be his goal. So today, if we are able to kind of, even all the banks today, whether we use analytics in what form, that really doesn't matter. What matters is, are we able to kind of, plow our existing data and give enough information, what is the next sale for a given customer? When we look back in our bank, we find there are so many lost opportunities. Today, including a bank, I'm sure many other banks, if one of our customer is trying to approach other bank for any kind of loan, I'm sure all of us are trying to, you know, we know about it and we are getting back to the customer. So why not with us? I think this is what the power of data. We know what our customers are doing. And see, today with the layering of social media, where the life event of our customers are captured very well, we know what is his next requirement. He has got his first job, he has married, and he has got his first kid, he is going abroad. We know the products that has perfectly kind of suited for those events. So in fact, I think many of us are using data analytics may not be in a kind of model which is very sophisticated, but in a manner which is basically internally there, we are able to churn data and use it. So data is, I would say, insurance is, because we are also largely, or most of the banks are selling as a bank in, assurance. Today, you know, it is quietly established that if somebody is very negative on his tweet, tweeting, so probably I think his life insurance premium would go up. That's what I think the joke in the data crunchers, the data scientist, is Donald Trump's life insurance premium will go up definitely. So this is what actually takes us to that level. Suppose if you are tracking a customer, which is very much true today, suppose a customer goes for a kind of bungee jumping, so we send an SMS immediately. I think your insurance is not covered. So this is an add-on. Why don't you purchase it? So this is what is the kind of power of analytics. And I'm sure like with the help of analytics, we are able to kind of, though publisher bank, like at least Andhra Bank, we have not started, but many other banks are able to position or propose a product when the customer is moving around a mall or during those places. So I'm sure we are not very far away from what we are discussing. We are already doing it, but more sophistication for modeling, specific modeling for Indian customers, I think that is what is required, because we just capture and adopt the model of the kind of Western world. So that I would need, I think some customization is required. So that's what I think we are very much there. If you see food processing, I think 2 days back we had a lot of discussion on the food processing. So food processing as a kind of business, it requires data. I think prior to the session we are discussing, it requires data from farmer's land till it is kind of exported and sold out to customers in Western world. So that is the level of data tracking and data accumulation is happening. And analytics on top of it, and definitely is going to add to your business. I feel we have already started our journey.
So that's a very positive note. I will challenge that later. I'm not sure we've done enough as the banking system, but let me not talk. And Amit, if I can get you to share your perspective.
Thank you. I saw a word called mindset out there, which was very, very important. The data usage in banking has been defined primarily by two things. One is the extent with which people want to rely on data or use data. And the second has been access to technology capabilities. Let me give you a little historical background. Banks started around 2005 to start leveraging data. The initial focus was to create a data warehouse, to build analytics tool. The primary focus was creating MIS for internal consumption. That moved into something called as analytics, which we started keeping on enhancing, where it went into a decision support system. Last 3 years, because we have access to better technologies, see as banks, we are not manufacturer of technologies. We use and harness the technologies which are available to us in the market. As new technologies have started coming in, as smaller fintechs have started making these technologies more democratic, today, in last 3 years, banks have started leveraging those new technologies and using them for doing almost magical stuff. And let me give you some examples of that. There used to be a time when you would go to a bank for a loan and it would take you maybe days, sometimes weeks to get a loan. Today, with the technology of data as well as the analytics that you have, you can actually get it in less than seconds. and we are able to leverage not only the data that you have with the bank, but also whatever data you have out there in the social media. We are able to predict what is the propensity of a person to buy or to do a particular thing. We do not have to go and sell in a broad campaign a credit card to everyone. We know that this is the set of people who are most likely to buy certain things. We can actually target people in a very, very definitive way. So analytics has moved from being an MIS-driven thing to a much more specific thing. Today, 50% of the bank's underwriting actually happens on the basis of data and analytics. It's not done by humans, and it's better. Why is it better? Because analytics models, they do not have a bad day. Humans have a bad day, people make mistakes. Today, the quality of our underwriting is much better on the basis of data and analytics, simply because we use and leverage the technologies. What's happening right now and what's going to change? The access to new technologies which are used by the fintechs of the world, you can talk about Google, you can talk about Amazon, you can talk about any of these large companies, are now available to banks through cloud-based mechanisms as well as on-premise mechanisms. Today we can have access to almost the same kind of tools, sometimes put under the umbrella of artificial intelligence, sometimes put under the umbrella of neural sciences, which were available with Google and Amazon, and we can start creating much better magic for you guys. Very soon you will start doing banking on a digital channel through nothing but a Google bar kind of a thing. It's just one bar. You, whatever you want to do, you can actually do that. We'll be able to give you auto assistance. I think it was mentioned as personalized banking out there, where you can actually, we can pay a bill for you. I know that you go and pay a bill every first or second of a month. You don't need to go and remember it. I know from your data analytics what you have to do. We can start creating auto assistance for you. Data and analytics is today becoming in line with every transaction. Every transaction is enriched. You do not do a single transaction which does not get a risk rating. The fraud for either a fraud purpose or for enriching that transaction, that if you are doing buying a movie ticket, can I give you something right over there while I can create an offer for you right over there rather than doing it on a standalone basis. The future is going to be extremely thin line between what experiences you get with a Google or an Amazon and what you will get with a bank. Give it a few more months, maybe a year or so. The line is, the difference between the experience is shrinking at a very fast rate.
So I guess to mix it up, we've had three bankers talk about where they see this. I'm going to ask Mr. Ashok Kumar here for introductions. He's not a banker, but he's a user of banking. But one as a user, but more interestingly, also from the perspective of a completely different industry, right? He's in the steel industry. He's with Tata Steel, so I will get him to talk about both of those, but you know, how do you think of data? We know in banking, many of us understand how data can get leveraged, but we will, you know, get his perspective on, you know, data across a very different industry. With that, why don't I give the mic to Mr. Ashok Kumar?
Thanks, Alpesh. I think that pack there was very insightful and it set me thinking. So as you heard, I'm not from the banking community. But if I recall my last sort of connect with banking when I thought of that, we get these series of text messages and emails about giving your Aadhaar number. And then I thought back a few months ago, they said you have to link your PAN and Aadhaar. And there was a little WhatsApp link which your friend sent you and you did it. So then I thought, but if they linked it and they have the PAN number, what is all this jamboree about? So I felt a little annoyed. So I don't know. I don't know the answer and probably not the right forum to seek an answer. So when I heard that conversation, I thought of the process industry. I come from the steel manufacturing industry based in the steel plant at Jamshedpur. So the way we look at information across industries, and that includes banking, must be similar, is my sort of assumption where I'm coming from. There is a reality out there, and there is a construction of that reality, which we create and act based on that. So in the manufacturing industry, one tends to think of this question of information or data as three layers. You measure something, you sense something, right? Like if you go and buy iPhone 10, it needs to sense your facial features. And then there is the next layer. It needs to make sense out of that. How to generalize it, how not to capture a particular mood, but to capture more general features. So that's the interpretative layer. And then there's a third layer, which is the control layer. You do something with it. So when one thinks of banking, pretty much the vision that comes to mind is like a doctor would give you a CT scan and know all your needs. Why doesn't the banker do that? And I think what Alpesh described a lot is getting fairly close to that. That's a little bit scary. But how to know more, how to interpret more, and then how to use it. So I will sort of just end with this insight and keep the story for later. How does this grow? And we have a hypothesis. You can have data, and there is a lot more data than is used. So what focuses it? What makes it useful? That's where I think the knowledge, the domain knowledge, is very key, because that can suck up what is the question one is trying to answer, therefore what data is needed to answer that. And when you get an answer to that question, then you look for more evidence to be sure. You want to talk to a few other people who tried to answer that question. So we have a hypothesis that digital challenges the domain knowledge. And then the domain knowledge asks new questions and challenges the digital technology. So there is this virtuous cycle. And I must say, over the last couple of decades, because manufacturing data is not new, the rate at which the possibilities have been going up has led to dramatic improvements. And I think that's where the promise really is in each domain.
Thank you. So that's, you know, as you said, coming from a completely different perspective. If I might ask Mr. Tandon to talk about coming back to plain banking, you know, from a banker's perspective, where do you see the opportunity?
Thank you, Alpesh. Let me talk about first your agenda. When you talk about your first question, I think that was 2015 or maybe a bit earlier. And I think most of the prominent banks here, public sector as well as private sector banks, maybe 5, 6 years, 7 years back, they were in the process of setting up infrastructure so that the data which is getting generated that can be properly interpreted and insights can be taken off. So we were also one of the front runners in establishing a data warehouse. And today I think our data warehouse is one of the biggest data warehouse, maybe globally, on a single instance. And the challenge is how to really take care of this volume, big volume of data. First of all, why this data is getting generated? Maybe as you said, Moore's law, storage cost is coming down. Maybe connectivity is going, network connectivity is going down, is available. And the prices of mobiles are also coming down substantially. So the penetration of internet is increasing in India like never before. So as I said, that today, humongous amount of data is being ingested and taken care of. I'll just take you on the demonetizing day, when there was a huge clamor in the India about the amount of demonetized note which has come to the bank. It was State Bank which did some innovation and reported the figure to the government, and they simply multiplied by four because 25% appears to be our share, our market share. And that was our ability, agility, and the speed through which we could, we were able to report the data. Now, coming to analytics, analytics is a bit established practice in the bank for 3-4 years. What Amit had talked, we have been doing all those stuff. And I'll just like to tell you that whatever predictive models we have done recently, we have launched a predictive model for credit cards. And where the accuracy rate is 80%, that whatever leads have been given, 80% of the customers have opted for the credit card. So that is the power of analytics through which we can increase our business, we can get business outcomes, cross-sell and cross-service, whatever objectives we have done, that can we can do it. Apart from that, on analytics piece, there is a huge amount of fantastic stuff being done by the bank, maybe to reduce the cost and others. Like one of the things which we are working at the moment is on how do we predict the failure of ATM machines. Because that is one of the irritant for the customers if my machine is not available for delivery of cash. And how do I predict it? So that's one which is going on through the analytics piece. Now, going forward, as you said, if I compare my bank, maybe 7 years back, there were hardly 7 or 8 applications which were running. Today, there are around 200 applications, critical applications, through which the data is getting generated. But are we able to take care of all these data? Probably not, because the current warehouse capabilities do not support, and it's very costly affair. So we are moving to big data lake so that the data from all over the place, which is available, whether it's on social media or which is inside available, that can be ingested and meaningful insight is created. So that's what we are working on.
So we've heard a few of the bankers talk about it, and like I said, in general, everybody is aligned. This is the 2015, or it's the journey has already begun. This is the 2015 agenda. We also hear a lot of the action that is underway. But we heard at least one user, and I would be the second one to challenge as well, saying, are we doing enough? And it's a rhetorical question. I think it's much slower than I would expect it to be. I'm a customer of at least 3 banks, and if I look at the amount of data that they have on me, it amazes me about how little it's getting used. So with that, why don't I get two of the, you know, I thought we would get more than bankers, so we have two quote-unquote fintechs. So I'm going to put them on the spot. This is not a question I'd given them. Your perspective on, do you think banks are doing enough? Before you then talk about what you're doing. So Nimesh, why don't you start, and then Amit.
So the thing is, with less than 500 MB of memory, right, we've sent the man to the moon. And today with even 1 GB RAM, we struggle to even run Facebook, right? So the thing is, it's not about computing capacity or the amount of data that you have. The focus has to be on the what questions do we want to ask from the data, what problem do we want to solve for the customer, and then move backwards. I think what is missing with a lot of banking customers that we're working with, the focus is too much. The critical aspect to set the rails in place, but the focus is too much on that without getting the business teams involved in terms of what problem we are trying to solve. And I think that is one thing which is missing. And second aspect is the idea that if you want to upgrade an entire organization to start becoming more data-driven, it's not going to happen by training them on SQL queries or teaching them how to use dashboards. What has to happen is we'll have to simplify the way they access data. And when you say data is the banker's best friend, so for something that we are working with banks is give them a very easy interface where they can just either drop in a mail, ask a question through voice, or have a Google search bar. Like you access information through Google search, you should have a search bar for your relationship or your databases and just get your insights coming out. So I think that should be the focus area. And how do you make it really, really easy for your operators who are running campaigns or your senior management who take decisions with data and give them access pretty quickly?
Thanks, Nimesh. Amit?
Sorry. So I have two perspectives to share here. And perspective one is that in most discussions, I find that there is too much of romanticism about what data exists. And there is a lot of talk about what data exists about in Facebook, on LinkedIn, on Glassdoor, and there's a lot of discussion about how can we get this data. I find there's much lesser focus on what data do we already have and what's the best use case for this data. As Nimesh was talking about, what are the different problems that we can solve for? What are the questions we should solve for by using data that we already have? So there's immense discussion about saying, listen, if I find my customer holding on Hawaii Beach, or a potential customer, what does it mean if I were to give him a loan? Is he a risky customer or is he a very safe customer? At the same time, the other part of the spectrum is where I'm a wealth management customer of at least two banks, and I still get pre-approved car loan offers for 2 lakh rupees. Does not do justice to the lifestyle of a wealth management customer. I'm sure a lot of us would share the same story. So right on this, a huge gap between what we're trying to get to and what exists on the ground. The perspective number two is there's enough differentiation that we talk about between what is called alternate data or surrogate data and something called a primary data. I don't even know how to differentiate what is primary, what is surrogate, or what is alternate. And I'll make it a very provocative statement. There is no alternate data. It's just data. And it all depends on what use cases can we have, can we think about for data that we have. And let me share few of the use cases that at least come to my mind very clearly. One, and as Alpesh was talking about the entire value chain for banking, let me pick up some of those value chains sections. One is simple cross-sell. If I'm a banking customer, the bank pretty much knows everything about me from just a bank statement and bank data that exists. The bank knows which credit cards do I use, when do I make the payments, it knows which home loan do I take, which car loan do I take, it knows about my salary. The cross-sell and targeting is so easier. It's amazing. The second, and which is what we see more often, is on the asset side, lending side. We do a lot of business on SME lending, and we find that some of the best use cases on underwriting and fraud detection and post disbursement monitoring come from just bank statement. And somehow it's just not glamorous enough to say, listen, let's data mine bank statement. That's core data that exists. And in the first few years when we were trying to still build Cointribe, we would at times, a number of times actually come out with hearing from some people saying, let's build a surrogate lending program using bank statement. And to me it was surprising because for banks, bank data is core, it's not surrogate. And to rely your underwriting decision on something which is as non-controllable as a financial statement, but to have surrogate linked to the bank statement, which is bank's own data, is actually it was a bit surprising. But there is a lot of use case around post-disbursement monitoring that that exists. In case a bank has given a loan to a customer and we track that end use being given to, it's not a non-revenue generating end use, because the revenues don't really go up in the next few months' time after a loan has been disbursed. That is a early warning signal, and which should ideally trigger an early warning signal to the collections team to keep a sharper focus on those accounts. So right from cross-sell to underwriting, fraud detection, to post-disbursement monitoring, pretty much some of the core sources of data, and bank statement is just one of them, are immensely, immensely useful, which I think we're just waiting to start the entire journey on.
So I guess a very simple point, but you know, one of the things I've heard, and I don't know the veracity, is that 90% of all data that is collected never gets used. Right? So the question is, yes, there is more data to get, but how can we use and understand the data that we have already? So with that, you know, I'm going to open this up. If the audience has questions for this panel, happy to take them.
heard about the AI that Access was developing. You gave the example of the bar, particularly where you can just input things like paying a bill. But when it comes to corporate banking, I've seen that the interfaces are quite rudimentary still. Personal banking is making immense gains in terms of technology. You have a lot of data on customers. But for more complex usage cases, scenarios, like in terms of, I mean, project finance or funding, there are a lot of variables involved. It's not very direct. Like, probably, like, you give the Cointribe example where you mine customer data, where you find customers who are, you know, the data is more easily accessible, or processing it in lots where the risk is lower compared to higher value projects. So where do you think is this going to come in, like, particularly from the corporate side, where we'll actually be able to make use of these technologies in ways where it can actually benefit us as a company?
Honestly, the right answer is retail is the leader in terms of use of data and analytics. Corporate is right now a lagger, but the gap is shrinking very fast. The first cases where banks have focused on for corporate has been more in terms of internal data analytics and process improvement, which could be related to early warning signals, which could be related to the way we use data for things like robotic process automation, for using some model building for underwriting, or for improving our own inefficiencies further. So that there has been a lot of focus recently, and I'm saying last 2 years, has been in terms of using data and analytics in corporate as well. It's still not reached the stage of retail where we have started using it for direct use cases for a customer where he can feel analytics being used and some solutions being offered to him, but that day is not too far. As I told you, the gap is shrinking at a very fast rate. In next few months time, you'll start them, you know, almost getting on par with each other. So it's happening.
The Cointribe example that was there, that customers that you're targeting particularly aren't like big customers in a particular sense, because there are more factors involved to processing more complex transactions. So do you think that it's somewhere getting there in terms of getting the data used up?
No, actually, corporate underwriting, IT system, definitely I agree, it has not caught up kind of the way it has caught up with retail. With retail, we can give a kind of pre-approved loan, but that is not the case with corporate, because there are many things actually you have to look at. Building a kind of analysis for corporate, unless you have your own data, so it will not be very correct. Okay, for retail, you can go either, you know, subscore, okay, his existing behavior, let's say in paying the utility companies and all, a lot of data is available. For corporates, it is his financial transactions which is today, it is a closed loop, you know, between the kind of financial organizations and regulators, but yes, processing corporate applications through IT systems is started happening. I think I would not say it is 100%, but quite, because there are so many kind of committee approach and all. So this decision is started taking place. But I'm sure what is monitoring is very, very strong. It will also need further strengthening. My sense is, let's say consortium lending. So in such, monitoring is required across kind of, within all those consortium vendors, lenders, as well as the corporate and his, basically, his supplier, his, where he gets the material from. So today, that part is little loose. I think blockchain, in a big way, is going to kind of close that gap, so that we have a perfect kind of monitoring on the kind of his spending, his receivables, and his the bank lendings. So I think that part, I'm sure it will come definitely one day. Without that, I think we'll continue to face the problem we are facing today.
You mentioned something about the fact.
Can I pass the mic over, because it'll just get too much. Sorry about that.
Yeah, thank you very much. We have been talking about uses. What are the possibilities of misuses of the data, especially with regard to two different regulated entities competing with each other in business, having similar set of data or same data, are trying to outdo each other. Do you think this is real a possibility? I'm not talking about criminals looking at those data, but the real business entities and something. So could you shed light on that? Thank you.
Anybody here?
Question was not very clear. Is it related to data privacy or data misuse? What is it related to?
No, I'm not talking about data privacy or any illegal use of data, but there are two business entities competing with business to each other, or maybe two banks, let's say. And then they have similar set of customers' data, profile, and all those things, and trying to outdo each other's competitor using those information.
See,
how ethical that could be, maybe how could it not lead to data war? That is what I think.
See, the future in terms of differentiation is actually going to be, and this is true for not only banks, but for most of the companies out there, is going to be their ability to leverage the data that they have or they can harness for their customers, and be able to create a differentiated experience for their customers. So organizations which do that well are the organizations which will survive and which will do better in future. So that is definitely going to be the key differentiator and the key area of competition for everyone. So if that is your question, yes, it is going to happen. People will leverage data much more. Whether it is harmful or not harmful, see, if till it is not being shared out into the public domain and I have a relationship with you as a customer and we have an arrangement where I can leverage that data for your betterment, I don't think there's any harm in doing that. And it is okay to do that, is what I'm saying. Yeah.
Yeah. One of the speakers has already pointed it out. Data which is already there in the domain is not being targeted to the customer who actually use that. Like for instance, he's getting an application request for a pre-approved loans. Similarly, another thing is like this data space is being used only for in the retail space also. It has a very limited use in the sense that it's just say pre-approved personal loan kind of a thing, and not for say other varieties of retail loans, like housing loans, LAP loans, loans against securities. And as I said, the target audience is also not the ones who are really looking for these kind of loans. So it's just like those who don't want those being getting frequent calls for the products which they don't actually need. So this is.
So what I can say is data, frankly, is nothing but it's a raw material. At times, while it's a session on data and we are all obsessed with data, in my view, data is nothing but a raw material, nothing more than that. How you use that data to complete or make a finished product or a value-added product is what depends on respective organizations. So the gentleman who asked earlier also a question on will there be a war, there's no war. Everyone can have access to data, but still different banks will have different credit quality. Why? Because how are you using that data with the other set of your decision-making process or using your analytics tool or depending on how you are using the data in the right context is going to create value, be it for an enterprise customer, be it for a retail customer, be it for a home loan or a personal loan or a contextual marketing or whatever you do. So I think data is important, but data is not the only thing that's relevant.
I couldn't agree more. So I think as I look at it, we are sort of standing between you and lunch. So I'm just going to request Deepak. Deepak, you started this the ball rolling. You've heard the six or seven of us talk about it. You've heard a few questions. You know, closing thoughts on it as you look at what's the key takeaway from, you know, for us?
So I think as the first question you asked, 2015, 2020, and I said 2017, where we are, I think everybody is getting on to this bandwagon, A, because it looks cool. Second, people fear that if you are not doing it, you are missing out. But that's not going to define your organization, whichever, either a banking, non-banking, or wherever you are. Because as I keep saying always, what it does for you is what will bring incremental investments, top management commitment, and all your stakeholders around. Some of the key examples, and I think a lot of us, including we at Kotak, have started to see benefit The impact is on the credit decision automation, because obviously you are able to do a better quality of credit and underwriting at a lower cost, faster decisioning, and it helps you grow your book. We have also been able to see a lot of use cases on the way you recommend funds, which is on the investment sides, because you have, again, tons and tons of data about the stocks and the funds performance. When it goes on to recommend, no more you go back with your old ways of recommending funds to your customers, looking at sectoral exposure, looking at stock exposure. So as you start seeing more and more of complex data that's coming in, and it's not just about recommending you the next best product or where to shop or where to dine, but I think ability to connect multiple data points and ability to bring in the real-time, contextual, relevant, targeted communication, which are action-oriented, is where different organizations will still differentiate themselves with the consumers. And as they see greater value coming out of it, let me tell you, some organizations will continue to spend disproportionate on this vis-a-vis others, because for some it will be still a tick mark because you want to do it, but you really don't know what the end game is. Or can you leverage, can you build a Netflix around data, or can you build an Amazon around data? There are not too many Netflix and Amazon, unfortunately. So I think this is where the defining moment of what you build with data will come in the banking industry.
So on those words, I close saying we're all waiting for that. So all of you on this stage, we are waiting for a version of what Deepak just ended with. As just users and followers of the banking industry, but more as users, we're all waiting for this future of, as you said, the Netflix or Amazon usage of data. So thank you very much. Thanks a lot.